So the question is, why doesn't he grow up? Why does he still behave as a child? How can we help him get rid of these leftovers from childish behavior?
Everyone seems to act childish sometimes, but I don't understand just why.
Different parts of our personalities grow at different rates.
So one side of a fellow's personality could be grown up, and another still infantile.
What we need is some method of measuring our growth.
Jail's musty.
The sound of fake laughing.
Yeah.
You ever have that?
What was that?
The other video?
No, like, was that kind of like a freeze, or were you actually doing that?
That was him.
Oh, that was me.
That was him, you silly
goose. That was me. That's the fakest laugh you've ever heard in your life. Like, whenever
we had those lame dinner parties,
when somebody's laughing and they go.
They're caught in a perpetual tornado of their own bullshit.
Dude,
still just laughing.
It's the weird. You've seen it. That is the weirdest human thing that we just do. We don't even realize we're fully giving away the fact that we are not actually laughing. Mm-hmm. It's the fakest laugh of all laughs.
I feel like a lot of people who wear boat shoes do that a lot.
Yeah. Just, well, because they're living in perpetual denial. What's going on?
What's that place?
This is what I was talking about with you earlier, dude. Mm. How easy it is in life to just go on autopilot. To not
fuck. I've been doing.
Oh, dude, we all do it. We go like there's
and a
moments.
Lot of things. A lot of things.
Moments.
Will get you there.
There's like there's days. There's like these 3 days. I don't even know what happened those 3 days.
You've been caught in a
like,
whirlwind of masturbation.
Oh yeah, that's a dead. Yeah. That it, when that happens, like
dude,
if you just get on
that
a
rabbit
kick,
hole is deep.
You're just like, man, I'm just gonna I'm gonna go all in.
I've been hanging
deep
out
into the internet. You don't even know where you went.
Hold on, are you saying that he is, or are you just kind of saying?
Well, no, he was.
I'm saying my wife left town 2 days ago, and I'm having trouble walking.
Yeah. too much jerking off.
Trying to stay in sweatpants. Because I live in a studio with her.
Boxers or no boxers? In the sweatpants.
Oh man, none. I'm just
Commando.
I got like a knife. I got a little piece of rabbit fur, just like
rubbing against
just
your
like
constantly.
Sitting on the edge of it, just like because it's just beat up, man. Can only take so much. I was telling Alec, it's officially to the point where it's like it grosses me out. Like it's like when you eat too much.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
And
the
you're
porn.
Like,
the
I can't even look.
The porn's
yeah,
too
like
much.
It's like I've indulged too much, and now I'm like, get it away. Like, I'm like, I've overdone it. I went too far.
What gets those people like the boat shoe guys, the guys that go to the Hamptons a bunch?
Yeah.
Why are they always stuck in the like? What is it about their life?
I don't know, man.
I think it's just money.
I think they just
and douchebaggery fitting in.
Yeah,
you know, it's a lot of work fitting in. You know
don't
you mean?
Think?
Like,
well, that
you
yeah.
Gotta, I can't even imagine like.
Well, imagine the fear that those guys must have.
Yeah,
I think about this a lot. Like dudes that are really well off, like how they all have all yes men around them. So the way I see it, these guys are getting no negative input ever.
Well, they don't have real friends.
Well, they're not real because they're actors. Their job is to tell them pleasing things. Like we know people.
Yeah.
There's one gentleman in particular that comes to mind that like that is
he's
very
there.
Affluent and and he's really interesting to look at because you don't get to, it's like looking at a unicorn. When you talk about like super billionaires, like really really rich people, there's not that many of them.
Mm-hmm.
So when you see him, you want to like look at him. You'd be like, what's going on with this guy? Like, why is he so special?
Yeah.
Like, what's in? All I see, the more I diagnose, is just like fear,
mm-hmm.
just constant fear. Because I don't think he gets any. I don't think he has any friends that are going to be like, yo, you look fucking dumb with those track shorts on. Man.
Why? Yeah, why are you
like,
wearing?
Why are you wearing those track shorts with that shirt? You can see your stomach under that shirt. You realize that. Like, they have nobody. Nobody. They fired or disconnected themselves with anybody that's going to be that honest with them.
Yeah.
So they're not used to those negative feelings, or not even negative, but just corrections.
Yeah.
Like, they can't take it in stride.
Real best friends will call you a fucking idiot when you need to call the fucking idiot.
Dude, when you're training hard with a group of other dudes and you're like around them all the time, dude, how much ragging on each other do you do? It's almost, ritualistic.
Yeah.
And it's like easy.
Stop being a pussy.
Oh, it's easy not to recognize what that does for you. And it does. It keeps you on your toes.
It makes you work hard.
It makes you work hard.
But it makes you check yourself. You have to want to hear that. You know what I mean? Like a lot of times when, you know, the amount of work and the amount of greed it takes to get to that, to make that kind of money, you know, you don't want to hear anything like that. Like, all you want to hear is like, you're great, you're great, you're great. And you just get so used to it that if anybody tells you, listen, like, you're, you know, this is not cool, or you're fucking up, you're just like, what? You're fired. Yeah. And that's, you know.
Yeah.
And that's just how it is. Like, everything and everybody can be bought. So if you're living like that, then it's just, you know, it's a whole different level of existence. And a true part of me feels like they're cool with it. That's what they want. And they have gotten, you know, like, if greed is your motivation, you spend your entire existence trying to get more. And it's not about you forget how many dollars, how many. It's like an athlete or a person who is like, you know, like, I want every woman in the world, you know. It's never, then it doesn't, it's not about the women. It's just more. Okay, what's the next one? Who's the next one? When is the next one coming? I don't even care what it looks like, shape, whatever. Just next, 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 more, more, more. So you get more money, more everything. And to have someone tell you, hey, listen, this, you know, you're not living right or whatever, just kind of throws you off of that greed path.
Yeah.
You know,
totally.
What I mean? So it's not like they want their life to be that way.
Yeah.
But they're happy with it.
But where is the line between having yes men and ignoring negative thoughts by people to where you're more encouraged to work that much harder towards your goal, whether it be shitty or not? Because those guys that we know did work really hard at a particular thing and got so far. So is having yes men or being too stuck in that weird zone that we were talking about a catalyst of being a badass for a while? Like, you eventually end up plateauing? Is that what that's from?
Whatever.
You know what I mean? Because there's got to be a balance.
Whatever it is you want, and whatever it is you're working your ass off to get to, you surround yourself with people who will get you there. It's not an accident that somebody becomes a multi-billionaire. Okay? Like, they're not, you know, they figured out a plan, and, you know, they executed the plan to get to that point. So whoever they have in your circle is helping them stay and improve where they are. Or else they'll let them go and bring somebody else in who'll do it. You know, if you're in the gym and
but
your
clearly,
goal is
clearly
to be the
that's
strongest
not,
dude.
Clearly that's not working. That method isn't working for those guys.
Because
if it was true.
Point,
now, what I'm saying working. Is like, if it was working, those guys would be fucking awesome. They would be like such ballers because they have all these people working on the worst parts of them and bringing them up into being the best existences and best versions of a human being as possible. You have someone really working on your charisma. You have somebody really working on your haircut and your attitude and your fucking this and your fucking that and your dinner skills. If you're really truly being honest with yourself and you're getting the results of having all these people that are really truly teaching you something, you would have a badass individual. And that's not what I see at all. I see these really stuffy, fat, white guys that like that don't have any sort of accurate perception of how they're coming across to the rest of the world, and it's because they have nobody correcting them.
But
they have no one actually doing it. They have people that they pay to be accountable for that, but they don't really want the result.
Exactly.
They just want to be told that they did their part.
But
it's lazy.
But I don't think they want any of those things.
It's lazy.
Because if they did, what they want is that one goal.
They want
fuck everything else.
They
want
to show up. I think that at that point, all they have is fear. I think at that point, there's no pride left. At that point, they're so disconnected, and all they have is fear that somebody's going to make fun of their haircut. I think they're such wimps. I think they don't have anybody in their life that's keeping them honest, that's keeping them accountable to who they are, because like you said, they're not going to keep those people around because those people don't understand them.
They shake the
ground. Don't understand what they're trying to get done. So it's like this inevitable part of becoming uber successful is you become an asshole.
Right.
Well,
that's what I was saying.
The only way that you can become great at anything is focus. They are focused on becoming what they want to become. And greed never ends. Like, there is no top to greed. So their focus is making X amount of dots. Like, just not even making X amount of dots, just make more and more and more. So they're not focused on getting in shape or eating right or being good.
Yeah.
The focus is on making more money than God.
Well, they're playing a different game.
Exactly.
They're playing this game. Here's the rules. Who can make the most?
So it's
who can have the most? That's so the game.
At a certain point.
And,
yeah.
And there's objective.
All they do
rules.
Is they hire facilitators. All, you know, oh, this is a chef that's going to cook my food and do this. Okay, great, hired. This is a trainer that's going to do this, hired. This is a driver that's going to get me from point A to B, hired. Yeah. This is a doctor that's going to do this, hired. Dermatologist.
Whoever.
Dog
whoever.
Walker, whoever.
Right.
Eliminating
can
thought.
Be part, can be bought.
Yeah.
So you have to focus on what it is you want to be great at, and they're focused on that. Everything else is just kind of like,
well, then
you know,
won.
Like I'm going to go to the gym. I'm going to show up to the gym. I'm going to show up to this. I'm going to show up to that. So in a way,
well, they're eliminating the creative process.
You got
to
hand it to
focus
them
on their goal.
Yeah, and no, they're creating. They're eliminating distractions.
Right, right. Any sort of bullshit, just
you
narrowing
know,
it on the thing.
Everything else is a distraction.
Yep.
You know, like a lot of what happens with quote unquote smart people and people who, like, you know, we're like, we're intelligent and I can do this and this and I will successfully.
Is that how they talk?
It's like,
is
shut
that
up.
How they talk?
You can't. You can't do everything, you know, and that's where people get all fucked up, you know.
No, you can't
like,
do
you know,
anything.
Like, I can do that.
It's easy to get
that. I can do it. I'm like, listen, you can't.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know how many people I told? Like, I remember I was in the gym one time, like in a boxing gym, shadow boxing, and somebody walked into the gym and they saw me shadow boxing and I could hear them talking to my trainer. And my trainer was like, oh, you know, this is the baddest dude. Da, da, da. He won the gold. He won the gloves.
Yeah. For people who don't know, Ngo is a Golden Gloves boxer.
Yeah.
Did really well.
That's what they that's he'd what,
kick
that's
your
what
ass.
They say.
He'd murder
kick
all.
The shit out of you.
Yeah.
Google so, you. So, whoever you
like,
are.
You fucker. Anyway.
He will beat you up. So bad.
So he's like, you know.
Ngo,
like,
put your knuckles up into that camera real
right,
quick.
Right there. Show them. What's
I
th- up?
I think they've healed. Like, they're not as big as they
look
were
look at his
before.
Fucking knuckles.
Yeah.
It's like a toaster.
They kind of like, they've gone down a little bit.
He's wearing mittens.
Put those away. Yeah.
Stop it. You're scaring people. Anyway.
Jesus.
So he's like, you know, he was asking about, you know, the Golden Gloves and boxing and, you know. So he looks at me, and I'm not all, like, my face is not all mangled and beat up. And he's like, you know, he looks like, oh, you think I can do that? And my trainer looks at him and laughs, and he's like, hell no. You know, because people who call themselves smart, I think I can figure it out.
There's an equation to this.
His white guy impression's getting better.
White guy impression's awesome.
It's getting better second time around.
I can figure this out. I'm like, get the fuck out of here. You know, a lot of people are like, oh, you know, I want to spar and go. I want to spar.
Well, here,
and I'm like, all right, cool.
This is an interesting idea.
Let's start light.
So going back to what we were just talking about, is there's some rich dudes, rich focused dudes out there. They're very focused on a game. Yes. The game is like who can make the most money.
Yes. Yeah, finance.
Now, everybody's playing some sort of a game, right? Like everybody's motivated to do something. Even the crazy dude on the streets
is
playing the game of like, let me see if I can be the craziest motherfucker on the streets. Wow. Like, I'm going to be crazier than that guy down the street. I'm playing a game.
Giving them.
That was
you're
my.
Giving them a lot of credit. Like, I think
you don't think they're competing?
Batshit crazy.
I think they're competing.
I think that dude is just trying to survive.
No.
Kyle's mind is like, no, this is a conscious effort to be crazy.
I'm like
that guy has been planning it.
I went to Homeless University and I got and I got a 4.0 GPA. Because I want to be the best.
Pull yourself up by your bootstraps, sir. Take yourself to law school and then go be a trainer. Yeah, get yourself in shape.
I see some muscle. It's a muscle definition in your abs. He's like, no, I'm starving.
No, sir. I'm poor. You
know, all like, right. I was giving him a little bit. Too much credit.
But what were you saying, Kyle?
Everybody's playing a game.
Yeah.
Right? What game are you playing, Ngo? What is the game of life that you're playing?
The number one Googled male model. Black male model.
You know, I think for me, it's like I know this is going to sound crazy, but we're all going to die, right?
Well,
and
that doesn't sound crazy.
That's pretty weird. For a lot of people,
we're all aware.
Want to hear that, right?
Right.
For me, I know that I may die an hour from now. I may die tomorrow, next week, next year, whatever, right? So for me, like, I just want to do as much cool shit as I can do before I drop dead. You know what I mean? So anything that comes into my head, like if I'm like, you know, doing whatever and I have a vision and it's really powerful vision, then it means that I have to do it. So whatever it is that, you know, enters my head and I'm like, all right, boom, this is what I'm going to do. And it's like, if it's vivid enough, I'll do it. It was the same thing with boxing, with modeling, with acting, with everything I've ever done. And if the vision is strong enough and powerful enough, I'm going to say, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to throw myself 110% into it and see what happens. And it's not about succeeding or being the you know, or succeeding or failing. It's just I have to do it. And everything I do, I have to win. So
this is let me sum up what I think you said.
Yeah.
And the game I think you're playing.
Yeah.
Are you playing the game of trying to make a masterpiece of your life? Like you're playing, if life were a painting, you're going to make the best fucking painting anyone's ever seen. You're going to make a life that you would happily live again and again and again and again because you're going to explore every option. You're going to live it to the fullest. Mm-hmm. You're going to hit the gas pedal, and you're going to see how far this ride can take you.
You're basically...
I don't know about all the art pieces.
Stop making it sound pretty.
I don't know, masterpiece. I just want to live. Like, I just want to live my dream from day to day. Whatever that dream is tomorrow... I want to live it.
Have you always kind of thought this way?
Yeah.
You know, I always have, but I wasn't very, it wasn't like clear. You know,
was there ever a point that it became more clear to you?
It was like a defining moment.
I would say a lot of it, like it started very early. Like, I was, you know, when I was a kid growing up, I was always like in and out of the hospital, sick and all kinds of, it was just crazy.
How, what, why? Know? Not like a bastion of health. How'd that happen?
And now, you know, but when I was younger, I had like all kinds of, respiratory issues. Like I had asthma. I would have bronchitis all the time. I was allergic to literally everything.
Was this in Nigeria?
In Nigeria, yeah. Okay. So I would go in and out of hospitals, and you know, sometimes I'll be there for a week, a couple weeks, a month. They just couldn't figure out what was wrong. They would treat me for pneumonia and treat me for malaria and treat me for all kinds of different things, but they just couldn't figure out what it was. And, you know, it came to a point where my parents thought that I was going to die, you know, because it was that close. Like
they How couldn't. Old are you?
I was 5.
Okay.
I just kept losing weight and couldn't keep any food down. And one of my parents' friends just said, listen, just bring him to Enugu, which is a different town from where we lived. Mm-hmm. So my parents just got in the car and just drove. And they got to his house, and he was like, this kid was just misdiagnosed. And, you know, he started giving me fluids and just a change of environment. And all of a sudden, I started getting better. And I just was never, I still was sick a bit, but not like life threatening. And so, because of all that, it kind of slowed down my growth and my progress. While a lot of kids would be in school, I'm home studying because I missed several weeks or a month of school. In my head, I just thought I'm going to use my brain to win. So
you just felt so physically weak.
Yeah. Because I just felt like, well, you know,
were 5?
I can't.
You're just little.
Yeah. But it kept going. So year after year, it would always be something. Mm. At 5.
Dude, was it just an immune system thing?
I don't know. It was so long ago. Nobody knew exactly what it was. Yeah. But after 5, I started getting stronger.
Do you remember ever thinking
that? At 8 years old, right? Uh-huh. My dad said to me if I got better, that he would let me kill my first chicken. It's kind of like a rite of passage.
Oh, okay. All right.
So it was not like a massive chicken, you know. So it was really cool to do it, because that's what men do.
Fuck, man.
You know, men do kill animals.
Can
men
we talk
provide
about this?
For their families. And at 8 years old, I was able to, you know, be strong enough and be, you know, be given the opportunity to become a man. So I did, I killed the chicken, and my mom showed me how to prepare it, and I did. And I wanted so badly to stay that way. But, I would regress. I would get sick again. But never to the point where my parents were afraid that they would lose me. So after that, I just knew that I wanted to just fight and fight and fight and fight and fight and fight and fight with my mind. And
did you ever think you were going to die?
I always feel I'm going to die.
So
to this day.
Okay.
Good
answer.
Yeah. So essentially the fear of death, you ended up developing, you know, a thought process that you could die at any moment, so might as well do as much as you can whenever you can.
Yeah.
Is that basically what just ended up happening?
Be it lifting weights, be it running on a treadmill, be it being here with you guys,
I really don't want to lose.
This truly can be it.
Yeah.
You know, so if this is it, like, would you want a half step into your death?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it doesn't, like, the truth is, and none of it, like, fear doesn't matter. Like, what are you, what are we afraid of? You know, like, none of us is ever going to come back. You know, like, when it's done, it's done. You can be old, you can be whatever. Like, all we have is this instant right now. And I've known that for a very long time. So when I'm working, training clients, that's what I try to, you know, teach my clients, or, you know, whoever I come in contact with. It's about, like, It's about do it now. Like, I don't want to hear, you know, I would like to.
You know how you can't?
You know, one day.
You know how you can't do it? When you're laughing at jokes that aren't funny.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going,
Boat juice too.
Exactly.
That it's so true. There's no
don't worry
because you're
don't be a boat chewer.
Paying attention.
No.
You're not looking at the fact that right now you have this amazing opportunity to like turn this moment into like the greatest moment.
This could be
the ultimate moment. At any moment, it could, and it any of them are available. All of them are available.
Yeah.
The one right now is available. You don't have to get to a place later, no. And those are the ones,
there isn't
the
next
moments
week,
that are only
tomorrow,
that are only valuable. No. Think how many people,
right now.
How many people are pissed about where they're at right now because they're not where they want to be or where they should be. They're not recognizing how awesome the
where
present
they are
moment is
like,
right in front of you. It's fucking amazing.
But it's like a lot of it just comes from the fact that most human beings are followers. That's where most of it comes from. You know,
yeah.
because they're followers, and because the reason they do that laugh is because that's like, this is what I'm supposed to do to this
is the custom.
To this stupid joke.
Yeah.
Because if I do...
well, if I don't do
they're
that...
They're going to like me.
Yeah.
They're not going to get mad at me, and I'll get what I want.
Yeah.
Not knowing that it doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't matter. Not at all.
You know, but then again, if you tell most people to lead, they'll be terrified. They won't know what to do.
There's a podcast of me doing it. Check it out.
Built to do. You know, if you tell a lot of people to do this podcast, they'll be like, no.
Dude, people do say they are not excited about just speaking the truth and how they feel about shit.
People have said no to us a lot about coming on
because
here.
Because somebody will hear it and be like,
I've heard some crazy excuses.
Said what?
Oh, yeah.
On why
on
they couldn't
podcast.
Make it. Pipes have burst.
Yeah, yeah, everything.
Emergency surgeries have happened.
What's the craziest reason / excuse that you've
heard?
Dude,
one guy for real said that he called me like 2 hours before the podcast and said a pipe had burst in his apartment.
Pussy.
And then his whole floor was flooded.
Yeah.
Oh, he could have just said, here's the thing.
He could have just said no.
He could have just said, dude, I'm nervous. I don't want to do it. And I would have been like, cool.
Yeah, because
like, that makes for good conversation.
Totally cool. Well, no, I wouldn't have made him. Like, if he really didn't want to do it, I don't want to make anybody come on this fucking podcast. That'd be terrible.
But the question is, why did they say yes in the first place?
I think that they wanted to be the guy.
It was a moment. It was one of those.
He wanted to be the guy that goes on a podcast. So wanted to be a guy that can hold up his that he's not afraid that he's going to be ridiculed for his thinking or like the way he comes across to people.
Yeah.
You wanted to touch on death before.
Fuck, I wanted to touch on what Ngo was talking about earlier about rites of passage.
That's really
intense. How, especially in America,
there isn't one.
There is zero for most fucking kids. Especially
21.
Men.
21 and
holy
shit.
You think so?
That's all we have.
But it's a bullshit
like 18,
rite of passage.
18 and 21.
It's
there's no, you killed a chicken.
Yeah,
and you prepared it. You took a life with your hands. You know what I mean?
Kyle,
like,
you
took the, no, I haven't.
I've killed one.
You took the responsibility of the meal fully. Like
killed
from
okay.
from the moment the beating heart. Yeah, I could do it.
Yeah.
Totally.
I could definitely do it.
How would you do it?
But it doesn't mean, here's the thing.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean I'd be happy about it.
No.
You know what I mean? Like, if I was hungry and I have to eat,
fuck that chicken.
I'm going to fucking kill that chicken.
Yeah.
And I will feel less bad about it.
Yeah.
But if I'm like, just like, if it's my job to be the chicken head cut offer at Purdue, like, I'm not going to be like, man, this is just the best. I love cutting
murder.
Off. Yeah, I love murder every day. Like, I don't want anything to like feel bad. I don't like if I can avoid it. Obviously, I accept like what I have to accept.
I would,
but
I
like
if you're gonna eat it, I don't feel bad at all.
Like if there was just a chicken, like I wouldn't just kill it just to kill it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I would do it if I had to.
No, of course. I mean, you know, but a lot of people can't.
I would feel. How about this? If you gave me the opportunity of eating one of the chickens that came from like Purdue, mm-hmm. or killing my own and eating it, I would kill my own and eat it.
Okay.
And I wouldn't be happy about it, but I would
you
know.
You wouldn't be happy about it.
Well, then I had to kill
it. Do you think if the roles were reversed, the chicken would think two seconds about killing you?
You're getting zero fucks.
Have you seen chickens? They're retarded.
They're deadless eyes.
They're so dumb.
They just look
they're
at you.
They're dinosaurs with feathers. They're fucking retarded. Kill
they're like a wall.
They're so dumb.
But anyway,
here's the thing.
I don't want to hurt their feelings. But anyway, no, I'm getting off topic. Rites of passage.
Rites of passage.
Fuck. We don't have anything.
No.
There's nothing. I think there's grown men that we see in the training floor that still need rites of passage.
The closest thing we have to rites of passage in this country is the most, I would say, is the frat system. And that's so fucking bad and terrible. It's just a terrible bullshit. Let's give each other reasons to hit each other with shit and get wasted. There really isn't one. And you're right, there's dudes that we see every day on the gym floor
who
can't go through a workout because they're fucking weak.
We should just send
all
18-year-old boys to Bud's training.
Oh, Bud's Navy SEAL of training. Yeah. And fuck. Yeah. Have you seen that?
We should expand the program. Now, like, here's a question. If that, say we initiated, like, there was a national initiative, just like the draft, mm-hmm. and it was, here's the deal. There's no more draft, but every boy 18 years old has to go to Bud's for 3 weeks.
It's a good idea.
And whatever the result mm-hmm. of your Bud's training goes on your permanent ID.
Like a C minus.
Like if you completed it.
If you were a little bitch.
Like right. You got like, a terrible like grade. If you do it for a day and then you like break your ankle, like you get, you know, a certain grade. And then there's like achieved full. If we had that,
now,
like in society.
What would that do?
It would do the same thing the chicken did for you.
I think
you felt like a man.
I think it would put pressure on. It would put pressure on every person to go through a crucible. It would force every single one of them to go into one of the most uncomfortable places ever and try to find the beauty in that moment. And if you can do that, you can turn anything around. Like that it's like you learn a new skill. You learn a new skill for life.
Or it can demoralize these kids.
Well, it definitely humbles them, man.
It'll humble you. The thing is, rites of passages, they don't have to be like anything physical. It helps. Mm-hmm. But like, I would say, my real rite of passage was like during a psychedelic trip I had. I had a real crazy life-altering moment. Yeah. And it was just because I was in a mental chaos for mm-hmm. like 13 hours. And it was the best thing I've ever done,
If you have a deep psychedelic trip.
Oh, that's you. Welcome to the other side, son.
Yeah, like, that is death.
Yeah, you die. Like, you basically die.
If you
and you're okay.
Are
with
you
it.
Familiar with psychedelic drugs at all, Ingo?
I know what they are.
Yeah,
you've never taken one.
No.
Okay. It's hard to explain, but it's like generally speaking,
it's a fight.
You lose your ego, mm-hmm. your sense of self. So, like, if you ate enough mushrooms mm-hmm. or took enough acid or you did enough of it, mm-hmm. your reality would be that of a newborn infant. Hmm. Like, meaning, like,
in every way,
it dissipates any inkling of Ingo as anything.
Yeah.
And the only way you exist mm-hmm. is in this moment with no idea
context.
What's going on. You had no context.
Yeah.
No context who you are. Everything you've ever done, everything seems to be wiped.
Yeah.
You still exist, though. You just have no understand. Like, you're looking at nine dimensions. Like, you're looking at stuff that can't exist because you've never seen anything like this before. Yeah. So it like imagine a newborn infant that's looking at the world for the first time and doesn't know that this is the end of this computer and you begin there or what you are or what colors are or what lines are. Is this all part of the same thing? Is it if I go further back, can I move in this space? Oh, time. Like you don't even know what the dimensions are that you're existing in.
Yeah. Yeah.
And in that state, you completely relinquish all the baggage that goes with you, all the ego, the life, the anything good or bad that you've ever done, mm-hmm. and you sort of come out of it like reborn, yeah. I guess. Like, you're back, but you know kind of what it would be to go away, to die. And like, you feel very much like you experienced death.
And to make it relatable.
And then you're fortunate enough to come back.
Yeah. And to make it relatable to you, it's very humbling in that you can't lie in a deep psychedelic trip. Just like, to make it relatable to, like, so you fought in a ring a bunch of times. Mm-hmm. You can't lie in the ring. Either you trained, either you practiced all your moves, mm-hmm. or you didn't. And if you didn't, you're going to get your belt rung. And that's mm-hmm. it. Like, there's 100% honesty in the ring. Just like when you're in a psychedelic trip, there's 100% honesty. And that's why anything, like, even like a boxing fight would be great to bring it back, rite of passage. Because, again, you have to be humbled and 100% honest with yourself.
Yeah, but kids would fucking kill each other.
Did you work hard? Well, Bud, do you think Bud's going to be any better?
Yeah. Well, I don't know. Probably people would die at Bud's, right?
Yeah, they would.
There'd be a lot of people to drown. And,
they'd die.
Yeah.
If you did like a psychedelic drug, uh-huh. are you aware while you're under the influence?
Depending on the drug, yeah. Yeah.
Well, it depends how much you took.
Yeah, that's, so, like, that's also...
It's like a sliding scale. Mm-hmm. You know, there's levels of it mm-hmm. where... You know, people see they say they hallucinate, right? They see things that aren't there, or they see things move. And that's because what you see doesn't look weird mm-hmm. because you're used to seeing things a certain way.
Yeah.
Right? If you start to sort of let go of the part of Kyle that remembers that's a couch and the part that remembers that's a wall mm-hmm. and you start to, like, just finally change the tune a little bit. Mm-hmm. Then things look very strange and unfamiliar, and they're moving, but they're not. Like, you can't. It's like your memory of these things that are completely going away. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's like
your OS is gone.
What, like,
your
in those movies? System, those movies like Back to the Future, where you just start vanishing.
Yeah,
that happens.
Like
that happens.
Yeah, it just, like, slowly. And I've had trips where I've fully vanished. I have gone. I'm not 100% sure that I'm not still there. Like, I'm not 100% sure that I'm not just caught up in what happens after death. I'm not sure this is the same one that happened that I left from.
And that can be a really good, powerful rite of passage.
Because it was really 100% was death. Yeah. It was death. Like, I was gone. I was gone, and I experienced something on the other side, but I can't describe it in this universe. Like, I don't have enough tools.
So why do you think,
I
don't have a way to describe it.
For something to be a rite of passage, you have to be able to use it
mm-hmm.
in this life.
Yeah.
You know, it's tough to say that, you know, I haven't done it. So I can't argue.
You don't have a context. Yeah.
You know, to say you experience something, but you're not quite sure, and you may not be able to use it.
Yeah,
dude, in this life,
I'm with you. The lessons.
I'm totally with him.
Certain rites of passage is like, okay, you have to kill a lion or kill a large animal.
That's crazy.
That's fucking a spear.
Have you?
Okay,
yeah. That's a
so
good
something
skill.
Like that. You can use in life because you are aware.
Kill the fucking lion.
You know, when you're in the ring, like, you're never ever going to be more
present.
Alert. Never, never more awake.
Yeah.
Because, especially, you know, when you're a guy my size, like, you know, you're going up against a guy.
How big are you? For those who are listening, 200
plus pounds. Okay. That has trained for years. In perfecting each punch designed to destroy you.
Oh my God.
Okay. So you have this in the back of your mind. And when you step in the ring, the audience is there. You know, people are watching you. His friends are cheering him. They're booing you. They're talking shit to you. Your friends are there. You don't want to let them down. All this is happening. And you're taking all this in. And you're awake. You know. And no matter what happens, win or lose, when you come out on the other side, hopefully you come out without losing too many brain cells. When you come out on the other side, you can use it in life, because when you're walking into another interview or an audition or you're doing a podcast, nobody is going to punch you in the face.
Hopefully.
You know what I'm saying? So yeah. what are you afraid of? You know what I'm saying? Like there's when I the first time I got hit for real, like, you know, I was, you know, training and my trainer's like, "Listen, we're sparring today." The first time I got hit for real, it's like I got hit in slow motion. You know, and it's like boom. And then it's like a split second, but that split second feels like it's like a week. Okay, so in that week, you're like, what the fuck am I doing? You know, like, ugh. The first thing is like,
yeah,
oh, damn,
dude,
that this light, like, it's like a light that flashes,
yeah,
and that flash takes you, yeah, you're like.
Dude, that's a psychedelic
trip.
You're doing the same shit.
You're just getting punched in the head. I told you. See, it's the same shit.
You're like, what am I doing here?
That's a psychedelic experience,
why
bro.
Why am I here?
We're eating mushrooms. Why? This like, guy is just getting chose. Punched in the face. They're the same place.
I chose to be in here.
You're burning down the house to bake a loaf of bread, son.
Yeah, man.
You don't have to get punched in the face to go through that, just so you know. It's pretty dope.
I'd rather do that.
Yeah, you crazy fuck.
I'd rather do
well, there's a reason why you
of course you would.
Yeah. You know.
Jesus.
And you're like, you know, why did I choose to get in this fucking situation?
Yeah.
And then, boom, you get hit again. And you're like, oh, it wasn't that bad. I could continue. It's not as bad as I thought it was.
Yeah.
And then you guys are fighting. Because now you're like, okay. I took your shot. Now let's see you take my shot. And then it begins, you know. So I'm watching everything. Like I can hear I can hear people cheering me. I can hear my opponent's friends cheering him. And I'm using their negative words. Like, you know, they're like, "You suck."
And I'm yeah, like, oh, using yeah, that for
I
motivation.
Suck? All right, I'm going to hit your boy hard. And you're going to tell me if I suck. You know, so kind of like that. So you hear everything.
You're like omnipresent.
You see everything and you feel everything. You
dude,
know?
It sounds like
it sounds
a trip.
Exactly like a psychedelic trip.
It's weird.
Well, no I difference. Mean, I, there's
I,
no
I,
difference.
I guess.
Well, there's
guess,
time dilation.
But you're
multiple. Resolve.
There's beings that mm-hmm. say shit to you that
yeah,
might not
apparently.
Be helpful or not.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. It sounds just like a psychedelic trip, sir.
They might be you.
Maybe,
you don't know.
Maybe.
But
it could be your own. Yeah, it could be your own negative vibe.
There's a time dilation that happens.
Yeah.
He comes to realizations about aspects of himself just due to the time. Like
fights
it,
off
it,
the
it
negative
is.
Aspects.
It's weird. If you fall, how weird is time? How weird is it that like all three of us? Hold on. All three of us have had experiences that felt like time changed,
mm-hmm,
and yeah. like in our own subjective experience. That like stuff happened, like you didn't just it didn't just go blank to blank,
mm-hmm.
right? When you got hit, like there's some experience that happened
yeah.
in between there,
yeah.
but your experience of it was like way longer than it actually was in
yeah.
this world. So like you know that your experience can get changed when your experience of time gets changed,
mm-hmm. right?
So like when you die, when time ultimately ends for you.
Mm-hmm.
Like, who's to say that that doesn't just extend into that? Like, that there's
like, a different perspective
yeah.
of whatever reality you were living
whatever.
At the time. Some
whatever.
Words.
Like, well,
for that.
If you're outside of time,
who cares?
Who cares?
Who cares, you say?
Who what? Cares? Like, when you're dead, you're dead. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, human ego just won't let us die. Like, we have to go somewhere. We have to be something
right.
else. We have to morph into something else because Ooh. We're humans.
Yeah.
We cannot just die.
Wasn't that the
Like when you're
the
dead, you're dead. Like it's over. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But we need to be something else. We're so great.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We're so great.
This
we
isn't
have
good
to
enough.
This is
now.
This is
we gotta,
you know, we have to now. Okay,
we need
this
a bigger
body.
iPhone.
Exactly.
We need bigger TV.
Soon we're going to be walking around with iPads in our pockets.
Yeah.
You know?
You don't?
It's like,
ooh, you
TV
don't?
Not good enough. Virtual yeah. reality good.
So you're saying yeah, it's ego. It wants this
oh,
forever.
Yeah.
Like, man.
All this stuff, like, you know.
You're scaring a lot of people right now.
Hey, listen, it's the truth.
Scared me.
You know? all this stuff that we want, that we would love to happen after we die, is just human ego. Yeah. Why doesn't it happen to animals? Like, why is it that when an animal dies, they just die? We're mammals.
Dude,
we're
just, you haven't seen a half-eaten caribou that a pack of wolves have been keeping alive by eating him from the ass out for a couple days so the meat doesn't spoil.
Shit's real.
You know, wolves do that. And that caribou, no, he didn't just die.
No? He morphed into the belly of the wolves.
Yeah, he nourishment.
Went to a real dark place for that caribou. He's still alive.
Thanks, Kyle. That was good.
It's 22
he
days.
Helped build, he started. Thought. He helped build some muscles.
You're right. He did.
Yeah. But we are fucked. What's with us humans, man? What's
I'm
our problem?
I'm scared as shit, ego. Man. Have you seen where we live?
Fear, man.
Have you seen where we live?
I say fear.
We live on a floating
fear and ego,
rock.
Same shit.
Fear
same stuff.
We live on a floating rock and floating around a nuclear bomb. Of course people need to invent some shit to make themselves feel better. You know how terrifying it is to exist?
All right, so how do you keep the fear and keep the ego at bay, you know? What are the things you can do every day to keep yourself in check?
Rites of passage. Work fucking hard
every
at something.
Every day.
Be humble.
Like, I don't even know what being humble is. Like, I'm gifted, and I am. You know, and I live with it every day. So I don't understand what being humble is. All I know is the most important thing I feel. And now I've learned to say, I feel. Because, you know, I'm like, you know, most
I'm sorry that you have
thing,
to say that. You don't have to say you feel on our podcast.
Yeah,
tell
we're
me,
not gonna
tell me what's up.
You know, people are always like, you know, it's not how I
dude,
feel.
Fucking tell me how you feel.
You're a white guy.
Don't tell me how you feel. Tell me how it is.
Yeah, tell me how it is.
Say how you feel.
Educate me right now.
But, you know.
The white guy impression's getting even better.
It's great.
I don't even know if it's like, you know, people are always like, why are all your impressions drunk? Why is that
drunk white guy?
Drunk white dude.
Drunk frat party white guy.
They're always drunk.
It's true. They're always drunk.
Maybe the voice is doing a psychedelic.
If you're on the sidewalk between 8 p.m. and 10:30, there's gonna be drunk white guys.
Yeah,
definitely, without a doubt.
What were you saying though?
Definitely. Like you're gonna run into multiple drunk white guys.
What were you going on to say though? You saying how it is?
Yeah.
Not how you feel.
You know, like our minds are the most important thing. You know, like our bodies are great. Like, you know, we're in a fitness world. We love fitness. I love fitness. But our minds are more important than our bodies. Because like my body doesn't know how much weight I'm lifting. Like my body doesn't know if I'm lifting 225 pounds or if I'm lifting 10 pounds. It just knows this is heavy. Now, my mind tells my body, this is heavy or this is too heavy, we can't do this. Let's freak out and protect ourselves. So if you spend time getting to know yourself, if we spend time getting to know ourselves, then everything else becomes easier. The fear becomes so much less because if you know who you are, you have an idea how you're going to react in most situations. A lot of people in this, you know, in this world, if you put them in a situation, they don't even know what the fuck they're gonna do, because they're not in touch with themselves, you know. And that's the most important thing. Who are you? From day to day, from minute to minute, you know. Like I try hard, and what I've worked on my whole life is, however way you see me, be it in the gym, be it at work, be it here in the podcast, I'm gonna be me 24/7. I'm never like I refuse to act or refuse to put on a show for anyone. I don't give a damn who it is. You know, like I could meet Bill Clinton, I could meet whoever, Barack Obama. I'm still gonna be me. I could be doing a TV interview. I'm gonna be me because that's all I know. Like I'm not gonna act for anybody because, you know, like at the end of the day.
Well, I think this goes back to what we were talking about at the very beginning, because you're not scared and you throw yourself in the fire daily.
Right.
And that's what we all have to do.
That's how you get better.
But you gotta throw yourself in the fucking fire. If you get so privileged that you never have anything difficult.
No fire. There's no, yeah. Why would you be throwing yourself in that
Nothing.
Position
you're,
if
so
you're
what,
that?
So what happens?
Like mommy fear, and dad, you're
bitch. Fear starts
you
to build. Right. Fear starts to build up.
Know. Mom and dad. Oh, I'm sorry. Mom.
But when you throw yourself you into the hardest workout at the hardest part, when you're barely breathing and you think this might be it, like maybe you know the you start fainting enough that you're like maybe this will be over.
Yeah.
You do that daily, then. Every other moment throughout the day. Like, what the fuck are you worried about?
You know?
You went through that.
It calms you the fuck down.
And you were all right. Exactly. You went through that and you were all right. This is nothing. This is nothing. What do you, like, what? Because somebody butted in ahead of you at Starbucks?
You know?
Like, what happened? What happened? You lost your iPhone? Nothing. Oh, fuck, man.
It sucks, I guess.
Your life is probably over.
All my contacts.
Oh, somebody.
All my contacts are gone. All my pictures.
Oh, like somebody said.
All my selfies.
Yeah.
I lost all my selfies.
Somebody said you got a bad haircut. Such bullshit.
What is it? What is it? Comfortability breeds death.
It doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. You're scared.
If you take life down to like life or death, nothing else matters.
Yeah.
Nothing else is that important. You know, this is why you see, like, families will never talk to each other and somebody dies and everybody shows up. Life or death, you know, until you're able to face it and face your mortality and say, you know, this is the real deal, you're always going to be afraid. You're always going to be afraid to try something, you know, and that, for me, that is not living. If you're afraid to do things, you're not alive. You're just like... You're just faking that you're alive.
Well, would you ever do psychedelics?
No, because I won't do it. Because
I'm a little
not
bit. I was.
It.
I was a little upset.
A little disappointed.
I was like, maybe.
No.
It's like maybe if. I...
Why is that the line? You're just talking about throwing yourself in the fire.
No.
But I don't want to.
I just
do
thought
it.
Like, what okay. a better person.
You know what I mean? Like,
this guy's not scared of anything.
I used to eat McDonald's, right?
That's just as bad.
And people would tell me, you know, that's not even real meat. And I'm like, it tastes pretty damn good to me. It's,
sure.
Have you had a McGriddle?
It's delicious.
Fuck yeah.
Have you had a McGriddle?
It's like crack.
Have you had a McGriddle?
Yeah.
I mean.
It's amazing.
Is that food?
No.
It is when I'm eating it.
Might as well inject
my
it. Into my veins.
It gives me calories.
Well, I guess you can call it. Yeah,
and
I mean, like,
me
I can eat it.
Energy to lift weights.
It's true.
You know what I mean? So it is food.
It's food.
You know?
You're
so
right.
What does that have to do with
it? Like, it just, for me, like, you know, like I talk all over the place a little bit sometimes, but what I'm trying to say is I do whatever I do because it's what I want to do.
Yeah.
I'm not interested.
Well, I'll tell you this.
I'm not interested in doing psychedelics.
Yeah, if you
I'm
don't
want to
do
it. You know, someone's like, well, why
don't
you?
It's not you, as you said.
Yeah. Why don't you do heroin?
Yeah.
Whoa, that's a weird.
And I'm like, I'm just not interested in doing heroin. If I wanted to do heroin, I would.
For sure, don't do heroin.
You know
for sure,
saying?
Don't do that.
Don't do heroin.
It just
nobody should do heroin.
No one, unless it's a doctor giving
heroin
it to you.
Heroin does not end well.
I want to be awake.
Oh, you'll be awake,
times.
Bro.
Like I want.
You'll be awake.
Aware.
You'll be as aware as you were.
A little
in the
too
ring.
Awake is the problem.
Too,
I think.
Yeah.
But you guys said that you kind of go somewhere.
Yeah. You go to the same place you went in the ring.
Yeah. Like
same
right
spot.
Where you go is to like
it's
so
totally the same.
Into the black hole of this moment.
Yeah.
Like that's where you go.
But I control
where the clock stops ticking.
Do you? You live on a floating rock in the middle of the galaxy. What do you control?
True.
Listen,
it's true,
I control the ground that I'm standing on right now, and that's all that matters.
Fair enough.
You know what I mean? Like, do you know how vast that rock is? Like, if we call it a rock on a, you know, floating on a rock. Yes, we're floating on a rock, but you know how vast that rock is? Like, where we're standing is insignificant compared to the size of that rock.
It's pretty big.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, in comparison to us.
Say that again?
In comparison to us, yeah, it's pretty big.
Yeah. So it doesn't, you know, like truly speaking, it doesn't. All that matters is where we are right now. You know what I mean? So I want to be, like, I don't want to take something that I can't control. Like, yeah, fair enough. If I'm on something where I'm like, oh shit, I don't even know, you know what?
Yeah,
where I'm gonna go? Right. Or, like, I want to go where I want to go.
Fair enough.
That's me. You know, like, I'm not judging anyone who's doing anything, because that's their, as Kendra, my wife, says, that's their journey. You know what I mean?
That's what my mom says too. My mom, she always says, "Ah, oh, Kyle,
it's your journey.
He's doing a podcast. He's on his journey." she'll listen to this.
So nice.
She'll listen to this.
Yeah. Will she?
Yeah, mom. On my journey, Fields. Mom.
Hi, mom.
I'm learning, mom.
She's
on my
so
journey.
Nice. She's the best.
On the journey.
32-year-old man on the journey.
Yeah.
He's just figuring it out.
32.
How old are you going to go now?
40.
It's like 10 years between all of us, basically.
Wow. Yeah.
How old?
Three different generations here.
32?
Mm-hmm. 22.
Wow. Yeah. I was running streets when you were born.
What are you doing that for?
You know, when you say I'm running streets, you got to deepen your voice a little.
Real
deep. You can't just say I was running the streets when you
when
were
did
born.
You, when did you move to the U.S.?
Dang.
How long ago was that?
When you were born in 93.
I was born in 93. Close, though. Yeah. Close.
Close. Close.
Wow.
Yeah.
Was that how big of a shift was that for you?
You know what the biggest shift was?
What?
When I walked into the grocery store.
Really?
I went to the poultry aisle. I thought I was looking at vulture meat, and it was chicken.
Wow.
It was massive. You know, back home, chicken is lean.
Yeah.
You know, these chickens are running for their lives, so they're lean. You know what I mean? Like, here, the chickens were massive.
Dude.
The chicken thighs look like human thighs. You know, everything was big. Like, the beef, everything.
Work.
The cows in the pictures here, massive. Cows back home were lean because they walk around and they graze, right? So you can see their ribs and... like, they're, you know, they could run and move and, you know.
Yeah.
Here, the cows are fat.
So fat.
Just huge. Just
gelatinous steroid machines.
That was, and we went to the grocery store the day that I landed because my uncle knew that I could eat. So he was like, he took me to, I think it was Walmart.
How old were you at the time?
I was 18.
18, okay.
Took me, you know, went to Walmart, got some new clothes. And went to the grocery store. And I was just like, people were just big. Just bigger.
Dude.
You know, like, I saw this woman walking in the grocery store. And there was something moving in front of her, right? Like, in her, something moving in her sweatpants.
Was it a fupa?
And I said to him, like, what is that? And he started laughing. He's like, that's her stomach. And I'd never seen anybody that fat.
How did that make
until,
you feel?
Up until
did
that
you get
point.
Mad?
Were you upset at her?
I just,
gluttony?
I, to be honest with you, I didn't know what to feel because
just
like,
couldn't
I just
believe
never,
like looking at an
was,
alien.
Yeah, was it like
it was
looking
just,
at?
It was just shock because I'd never seen anything like that.
That's
you know,
awesome.
And it was just so it didn't look human. To be that big, or at least I hadn't seen anything
dude.
Like that before. But now it's like now it's the norm.
You know how fucking crazy,
it's crazy.
KFC's chicken are. They are. You know how long
don't even
they
get
live?
Me started on that.
They live from birth, from the egg
uh-huh.
to fully blown up giant chicken to death.
4 weeks.
What? How long?
37 days.
What?
37
That's
days.
That's how much roids they're giving up? Oh, my God.
That's hold like, on, hold on. 37 days.
Days. Days on average.
That's bananas.
How?
Steroids, bro.
Bro. Have you even seen? I think they come out without feathers.
I don't know about all that. But
so they're genetically.
They don't have beaks.
Yeah, they're on
no, they
every.
Don't have, they don't have beaks.
They're these birds.
They're beakless.
They can't even walk most of the time because they're so fat. They just sit there and grow.
Dude, look at this.
Just full of
can they
steroids.
Get that big in 37 days?
You ever taken steroids?
Bro.
It helps
give,
a lot.
You ever give growth hormone to a chicken?
Yeah, it's GH, bro.
You know what happens?
That.
Yeah, they fucking blow up in 37 days.
growth. That's a crazy
and problem. Then here's the thing, and you just keep breeding the giant ones, mm-hmm. and then you have
super giants.
Super giant ones. Yeah. They're all related to each other. They're all brothers and sisters.
You know, I think what would be a cool video would be like a time lapse.
Of a chicken?
From 37 days. From day one to day 37.
You could keep one on for that.
There is one?
Jail's on it. Where he says there's one.
Wow. That would be fucking crazy. That would be crazy. You know.
So, how did that end up shaping your perception then of Americans just seeing this lady just like waddling around?
Mutant chicken.
Which is mutant chicken lady.
I just never wanted to get there.
That's where fat people can be really motivating. Like when you see them and it's so bad that you're like, never. I will never look like that.
She looked uncomfortable.
Just to live.
It is.
She's probably saved lives.
That's why I have. I was talking to him about it on the way here and you a couple days ago. That's my fucking beef with this whole the hashtag F your beauty standards thing. But that obese model, what's her name? Tess Holliday. Fuck that lady and everything she represents.
All right, Alec, this is how we're going to do this. We're going to talk about what the case is.
All right. Mm-hmm.
And then we'll come to our conclusion fuck that lady.
Okay.
What's her name?
I'm still saying fuck that lady. Tess Holliday.
Tess Holliday.
Yep. All
right, so what's she want?
Tess Holliday wants everyone to accept the fact that some people are obese and that's okay.
Well, don't you think here's a question. People are generally not lynching fat people.
They shouldn't.
It's not
like, and that's okay. If you want to be fat, be fat.
Yeah.
But don't be fat and then try to force what you consider to be beautiful, in this case, your fatness, onto other people. Because now her thing is like,
I don't think that'll work.
Of course it won't.
Because here's the thing.
But it promotes unhealthiness.
If people aren't attracted to a certain look, they're just not going to be.
Well, there
are, though. It's not like she's going to change culture. She's not going to change what Ngo thinks is attractive and isn't attractive just by, like, tweets. Like, that's a fool's it, like, Aaron, if that's what she's trying to do.
But what she can do is make people who are overweight
think it's okay.
Yeah.
And
anti-evolutionary.
Right.
That's fucked up.
You're a walking cancer at that point.
Personally, I think it's dangerous because...
Could you pull her up first?
It's not...
Oh, actually.
I'm just looking at it, not even from an attraction point of view, but a health point of view.
Just a human point of view.
You know, like it's hard. Like it's just crazy.
Well, it's weird because you're right. She's cultivating a group of individuals that are promoting something so unhealthy. Yeah. It's not going to spread amongst everyone. But like, if there's an impressionable young person who doesn't know any better, that could be the cause of him or her just deciding not to get better because it's okay to be, a walking representation of what it's not to be okay. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Like I can't even certain things I don't even want to talk about, but because you have diabetes as a crazy high killer in this country, heart disease, amongst so many other.
That's Tess Holliday.
You know, it's crazy. It's crazy.
Yeah, it's a,
you know, just say, listen, I'm giving up.
Right.
I'm giving up, and
I think that's what bothers me the most. Because they're tapping out.
If you want to give up, that's okay. But don't give up and then say that I'm happy.
Yeah. And then spread your weak message amongst other unhappy people. Like, don't do that. Like, that's a person who never went through a rite of passage. So go back. She does not work hard. In my opinion, I think the one thing you should do in life is take care of this meat wagon that you're allowed to experience life in. Like, why wouldn't you take care of this? It doesn't make any sense not to. Because if it's awesome, then you're going to be able to do things more awesome.
Yeah.
That's just how that works.
You know, the human body is designed to move, you know, and if you can't move, then problems start to arise, you know, and that's my issue. You know, like I said, if you as an individual want to give up and say, this is who I'm going to be, cool. But to now start a movement and to try to get people to give up because you gave up, that I'm not cool with.
It's no bueno.
You know? But you know, it is a free country.
America.
You know, this is America.
This is America. I don't think it it's
a free country. She can do whatever she wants.
Fair enough. But, anybody's gonna take it seriously.
But the thing is, you'll be surprised what people take seriously.
Yeah.
Scientology.
You know,
Scientology, man.
Fuck.
Like, dude, remember, saw one at one point was like, nah, it's not going to go far. Yeah. Really?
It did.
Clearwater, Florida.
$5 or $6 billion.
Yeah.
Fuck. You know, yeah, I don't know, man.
I'm just going to leave it alone for now
and bottle
it. I'm going to keep my hands off that one.
I try not to talk about people because it has nothing to do with me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it has nothing to do with me. It has nothing to do with what I'm doing. It's just, you know, she made a choice.
Yep.
And anybody that follows what she wants to do, that's on them. You know, when you wake up and you're like, damn, I may lose my foot tomorrow, let me know how cute that is. You know, diabetes is real. Like, you know what I mean?
That shit
like
sucks.
You can eat yourself into diabetes.
Like, she's not convincing me, Alec.
No.
Well, you know, we're so in fitness.
I don't feel like there's even any danger to her. Like, what is the risk?
For her? No.
What is the odds that Tess Holloway, through all of her efforts, will convert Kyle Fields into adopting this?
0%.
And none. 0%. So if it poses no threat... Then, like,
though.
Who gives a shit?
You know, I guess I have more of a personal vendetta because I was once a fatty.
Yeah.
And I was a young and impressionable young person. And maybe if I was young, I would be like, oh, it's okay. It's okay to be fat. Okay. I guess that's why I get mad.
But, I mean, it is okay to be fat. The way I see it, man, if that's what you want to do and that's who you want to be, then that's who you're going to be.
I guess they can be your own existence.
They don't like to be... Dude, people... Nobody... Here's the thing. Not just that. Nobody likes to be told... that they're in full control of their lives. Nobody. They want to put some sort of blame on some external this, external that. The people that I know that have taken full charge or the most control, most responsibility for their lives are the ones that I think, like to me, are the most successful. Mm. You know? So whether or not, like of course there's things that are out of your control, but if you act as if there's nothing that's out of your control... Mm. Those are the ballers, man. Those are like the people that I just want to be around.
Yeah.
Like they just seem to.
Well, they're doers. They just,
seem to be awesome, man. You know, like they're
living
they're
every day.
Usually cool people. They're living every day, right? They're living as if they're in full charge of everything that happens.
Yeah.
So they have an effect on every single thing. Like anything is a potential moment that they can affect.
Yeah.
And they took that responsibility. Most people don't want to have that responsibility. So they want to think, well, it's because of this thing or that thing. And that's something that really pisses me off in training in general right now. Because there's this big fucking move in this direction of it's not your fault because of this.
Mm-hmm.
It's because of this ligament to this. And it's because this energy system
the corrective
to this.
Stuff
and it's because
whatever.
Your spinal vertebrae here is because of this. And it's because you're having this because of this. And it's everything except for it's your fucking fault for not putting enough effort into whatever it is that you're trying to achieve.
Like I feel that instead of just pushing people to do exercises and movements, you like trainers or fitness people should push them to work hard and do the best that they can all the time. You know? So instead of saying, you know, oh, you know, we're going to do a bench press or we're going to do a squat or we're going to do a deadlift, I want you to work as hard as you, like the hardest you can work. In this hour that we're here together, let's get you to work as hard as you can. That's the message.
Because until someone does that, you can't start training.
No.
No.
Nothing matters until you can do that. That's
you'll never grow physically or mentally
if
you don't understand hard work.
Here's the thing. And it takes some people fucking 10 years to just get that first step. And then they can start training.
Yeah.
But at some point, you got to throw yourself into the fire.
Yeah.
People are so scared of working out hard. That's funny.
It's terrifying for people.
It is really funny.
They get a real bodily reaction of, I might die.
Oh, they get so scared.
Because this is gonna hurt.
Yeah, oh. It's gonna hurt. It's uncomfortable.
This is gonna hurt, so I'm gonna run away from it.
Yeah.
Like, I will,
not literally.
Like,
sometimes literally. Sometimes.
I can't even run a 4.25, but I run a 4.25 away from pain.
Seriously. They're so afraid
of
pain.
And that's what, what is it? Like, you're not going to die from it.
No, you'll be fine. You'll be fine.
You're not
better.
Gonna die from it.
It's gonna be uncomfortable.
May become better.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
On the other side of it, you know. But the problem is, a lot of trainers, and I dare say most trainers, do not work out.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Most trainers don't train themselves. You know, most trainers don't train themselves. So if you don't train yourself, how can you teach someone to train?
If you're not that walking,
you know, if you've never put yourself through pain, how can you teach someone else to go through pain?
You can't guide somebody through woods that you've never been through.
You don't know what it's like.
It is sad.
It's a shitty tour guide.
Well, and what you're saying too, like, there's not just trainers that don't work out. There's trainers that have never been through that crucible. Like, that have never worked out hard. Mm-hmm. Like, that never, ever. Like, respected trainers. Like, guys that pull flack in the industry and charge a lot. Yeah. They've never done it, ever. They don't even know what it feels like.
Yeah.
They don't
so
want to.
So weird.
And people who would scoff, like, Alec, at the idea.
Alec is studying for the NASM.
Oh, God.
And he's telling me about all the shit that he has to, like, memorize for it. And it's like, dude, they're not trying to make you a good trainer. They're trying to make
good
you
salesman.
Sound like a good trainer.
Course.
They're just teaching you a bunch of words.
This
so
is
that
closed
you
chain
sound
movements are really good for the eccentric load of the iso. Fuck out of here,
just
with your bullshit.
It's
the book.
Sound
the book
fancy.
Should be one page. Just say work the fuck hard. That's it.
Yeah.
That's the whole book.
Yes.
Work the fuck hard.
The best. Like, the
you
best
can't sell that though, Alec.
The best trainers in my book are trainers that are in the biz. That got in the biz from the inside out. People that were already training before they became trainers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, working out hard.
I think working out hard.
Yeah, working
training
out
hard.
I don't even think you had to be working out.
The worst trainers in my book are people who just read it. Mm. Who bought a book and read it. And now they're telling people what to do. You don't know what
it's that guy that writes a biceps
about.
Article who's never done a curl.
You know?
That fucking guy.
You don't know what you're talking about.
You know who you are.
Like, you've never felt client is feeling. So how can you help them when they're going, like, when they hit a wall that you've never hit, how can you get them past that wall? You don't know what the wall is.
You're just
is.
Going, at that point, you're going for
you
the
know?
Ride.
You're just faking
you're
it.
You're learning more from them than anything.
You know, you're faking it. Mm-hmm. And a lot,
the worst
these,
trainers.
A lot of these trainers are fucking fakers. You know, and the sad thing is they know it. And that's why their clients don't get results.
Yeah.
You know, if a client has been going to a trainer for years and nothing has happened, that's the trainer's fault.
Well, I mean, the way I see it is either
it's the trainer's fault. Because you, where is your...
Either they should be gone
Who's the accountability? Who's giving? Who's taking accountability? Okay, if somebody is training with you for 6 months, and nothing has happened, you have as a trainer have to be able to say, listen, something's not happening.
Yeah,
you're either destroying some food, or the program's not working.
Mm-hmm.
Let's reevaluate and come up with something that will work. If a trainer truly cares about the client, you will come up with something that works. If you walk into a restaurant and order some food off the menu, you want the food will come the way you ordered it because the chef is a specialist. If somebody walks into a gym to a fitness specialist, they should get what they want if they follow the rules. If they're training with you for however, like several months and nothing is happening, somebody's screwing up. Either you or the client.
Mm-hmm.
Something is not working.
There's a disconnect.
There's a disconnect somewhere.
Yeah, I mean, so long, if you're a competent trainer, someone who's actually, like, gone through the thicket, like we just said, mm-hmm. if so long as they follow your parameters, you'll get results.
Yeah.
End of the day. If, I mean, yeah, you're right. There are those people who, I mean, if you can't fake, how long can those guys fake the funk though?
Nah, they've been faking the funk for decades, you know, because the client doesn't know any better.
Yeah.
And again, most human beings are followers. So if your trainer is telling you, you know, this is how it is, even though you're not getting results, you don't, you know, you're just like, hey, you know, this is what they said, so I'm just going to follow it. I don't want to buck the system. I don't want to get him upset. I don't want to get him mad. So I'm just going to keep doing what he says to do, even though it's not working.
Do you feel like that is also just a way of just to give yourself another excuse, like we were talking about before? Because they gotta know. If you have a shitty trainer, you gotta know he's shitty to a certain extent. Like, if your trainer looks like he needs one, like, do you think someone they just become comfortable knowing that, oh, whatever, I'm going to the gym? But, you know, because if they work out with someone like you or Kyle, it's like, you better be ready to work hard. Like, and I bet a lot of the clients might not want that.
Well, I mean, they're trainers that are fit. Or look fit, that don't work hard and don't push their clients hard or don't really care, because for them, it's a business, it's another paycheck, you know, and they sit around and talk about, you know, how to maximize and charge the most amount of money to make the most amount of money instead of trying to come up with ways to give their clients results, you know, and get them what they truly need, which is to look better and feel better.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, like.
So then how do you go about? Because some people, I mean, I'm sure you get some people who don't want to get into that mind state. How do you handle it? That's a weird thing to teach.
I let them go.
You don't even handle it.
You know, I push and push and push. I coach, I encourage. But if they're not into it and they don't want to get into it, they're wasting my time and they're wasting their time. Mm-hmm. I told a client, listen, you're better off meeting me down at the corner and getting, you know, handing me the check and just going home because you don't want to work out. You know, you come in here and you complain all day. I tell you to do this, you don't do it. You go home, you order all the bad food in the middle of the night. You order ice cream and you don't even keep it. It's not even in your fridge. You don't even go out and get it. You order it and they deliver a couple of pints of ice cream and you eat it all. Like, what are you doing? You know, I have no problem calling people out for what it is. You know, if you're not doing what we're talking about, it's okay. If you don't want it, it's okay.
Yeah.
You don't have to do it. You know, but my thing is, don't waste my time and don't waste your money. But if you want to donate to charity and give me the money and just go home, like I said, I'm all for that. You know, but I straight up tell them. I tell my clients the truth. Okay? It's been 8 weeks. Things are not changing. What's going on? How's your diet? Is this program working? Is it not working? You have to constantly check in. And you can't be afraid of losing the clients by telling the truth. You have to tell them the truth if you truly care. You know, if you don't care, you can pacify them and say, oh, well, you know, maybe, you know, your metabolism is slow or, you know, maybe.
Well, yeah, because you become a yes man.
You become a yes man.
Do you want to be a yes man?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. You want to keep them happy, but you're not keeping them happy.
If you become a yes man, you'll stay employed.
Yep. And you'll make money.
I might refer you to my friend over here who has a lot of good businesses and
hook you up.
You got to play ball. You going to play ball? You going to say I'm working hard? You going to do that for me? Huh, sport?
You gotta,
tell me I'm working
you,
hard.
You got to do the laugh. Right. You got to do the laugh after that.
It's true.
We have to do it.
Game.
We have to do it in unison. Okay. We got to do it in unison. All right, ready? And then then you get paid. That's the sound you got. You got.
Then like, you get paid. You go, that's the sound of getting paid.
Exactly. After you go, you like to ching.
Ching. It's also ironic.
Senator,
the check has been deposited and it will clear.
King, that's ironically the same sound your body makes when you lose your soul as well. Yeah. So, weird. Weird that those two are connected.
Fuck yeah, man! It's true.
Know, it's crazy. It's crazy. But that is fear.
Scared. It comes what are you back scared of? Fear. Fire this fucker. You what are you know, scared of?
Tell the client. Listen, it's okay.
I tell my clients
you don't
want
to work.
I have clients that don't work hard, and mm-hmm. I've had them for years, and I just tell them they don't work hard.
Yeah,
but it's fine. Like we're on the same page. Yeah. Like you're never, you know, nothing is gonna happen to you
with this effort here,
with what you're doing. Like nothing, and they'd be like, "Yeah, I know. I just like coming in, hanging out with you.
I just want right. to. I just want like, to check okay, the box.
Well, that hands are clean.
Yeah, you told them.
You know, and then once you establish that, like that you're on the same page, mm-hmm. it's all fine.
Yeah.
Or at least in my book, it's been fine. Because like nobody's lying to each other then.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like, and I believe you're allowed to go to, some people just don't like to work hard and it's just not going to happen for them. Yeah. And some of them like to go to the gym. Mm-hmm. They like to get a break away from whatever bullshit it is that they're like dealing with.
Yeah.
And they get a place to go that's, they're going to talk to somebody that doesn't even work for them mm-hmm. or like owe them or trying to get something from them. Mm-hmm. And they just like the ritual. And that's cool. If that's what you want to do. I'm not going to like tell you can't.
Yeah.
But I'm going to be honest with you about what it is that you're doing here. You know, and what to expect.
I just, you know, I can't. I'm just not good at playing the game, I guess. I'm just not.
Those are the people I like to hang out with.
I just can't. Because we don't have to do it in the gym. I'd rather be down at a diner or a restaurant. Let's hang out. Let's have a drink. Let's get a good steak. Let's hang out for real. Like we're sitting here, I'm picking up weights, putting my back in jeopardy for you.
For your bullshit.
You know what I mean? Like you're not even trying to work. I'm gonna fuck around and pick up a heavy bar.
What are you doing?
Throw my back out for no reason. You know what I mean? I'm like, let's go get a meal.
Might as well, right?
We can talk for real.
I did that with a client.
And get paid.
Mm. Well, what most people need, I think, if we've actually like come to some conclusions here, almost more than a personal trainer, they need somebody to tell them the goddamn truth.
Yeah, they need a friend.
They need a truth friend.
That real friend.
Everybody,
Like, hey, man, you're fat right now.
You just need somebody that's going to be brutally honest with you. Brutally honest. And that you can't fire or get rid of. Like they're in it. You know, this has been your friend since you're 8. It's not changing. It's you like know? So you gotta fucking deal with that every day. You can't go on autopilot. You're gonna have to deal with the fact that your buddy here is gonna like tell you the truth over and over and over, especially if you like fail to do anything about it.
So
you know, it's just gonna get worse. It's like that's what everybody needs. Nobody's really hiring that guy though.
No.
That's weird.
Cause he's not cool.
Oh, man,
that dude's he's a buzzkill.
He's a dick.
You know, that dude is a buzzkill. Like you're living high. You know, you're
he's
like,
just
yeah,
like,
dude, you know, I'm killing it. And they're like, nope.
They're nah, like, dude. Let me tell you all the shit you're doing wrong.
You know, and you're
it's
like,
a lot.
Damn. Damn, it's all wrong. Why am I living? Why am I here?
Yeah, they need a little bit of that.
If we eliminated bullshit, like if we cut the shit, our lives would be so much easier.
Fuck yeah. Like, but here's
stress,
the thing. Do you really want them easier?
Illnesses.
I think what we've been covering is like it's we don't want it easier.
We want it harder in certain ways. I want my life challenging, not hard.
Yeah, okay.
But I want it challenging. You know. Well, I want it challenging and positive with positive things.
Yeah.
I don't want it hard with like things I hate.
Right.
And people I hate.
Yeah.
Being around people like piss me off.
But you need challenge.
You know, people that irritate me.
No.
You
negative
know, like
Nancy.
If I have to be like this before I train a client? Hell no. Yeah. And I know a lot of trainers are like,
but one thing denotes the other. If you're busting your ass and you're working really hard, you don't really need that guy telling you what you're doing wrong.
No.
You don't. That guy telling you what you're doing wrong is like, that's reserved for when you're way off course. Like, you've got nowhere to go. You're not working out. You're not doing shit. Like, you need somebody that really pulls you back.
I agree. It's hard to find that person who will tell you the truth.
Oh, fuck yeah, man. You might have like three or four people in your whole life that are really going to be honest with you.
You're super lucky.
Like, you're lucky if you have, three or four people.
That's
very
true.
You probably have one person.
Yeah. The reality is, at any given time.
It's not the right.
It's a hard, that's a tough commodity.
Hell yeah.
That's why you have to like stay. You know, I think that something that I've found challenging since I've been married is like getting out of the social circles that are just going through the motions, and make sure to maintain the friendships that you have with people that know you exactly who you are.
Yeah.
Whether you're a millionaire, whether you're a janitor, you're going to be treated the exact same by this person.
I'm learning this now.
What's wrong with
janitors? And you have to, I'm just saying that money doesn't affect friendship. Joking. I could have just said that. I'm sorry. There's nothing wrong with being a janitor.
Kyle, you're my father with a janitor.
There's nothing wrong with being a janitor.
Send the white man.
A friend who is not influenced or affected by the money that you make.
You got to throw an uncomfortable curveball.
Could have been a very good.
My brother's a janitor.
Could have been a very successful janitor. Yeah. You know, that really put in his time. Works for Microsoft. Nope. Bought stocks in the 70s.
Not even a little bit.
Damn.
Could be
Can
that
you
janitor.
Imagine?
Nope. No. Didn't happen. If you're doing that, you're not a janitor.
If you bought stock
in Microsoft, when Microsoft first went public, you'd be stupid rich. But I don't think I'd be able to handle it. We talk about this.
I'd dive into a pile of cocaine and hookers. I'd die immediately.
I'd be dead, dude.
All the cocaine and hookers. I'd be fucked.
I'd be corrupted.
You don't think so? I'd be dead for sure.
No.
I'd buy a brothel in Brazil and just live in drugs.
There'd be too much.
You would be going to brothels now.
There's so much shit, bro. Dude, too poor.
You'll be going. You'll find affordable brothels and go to
I'm good.
Exactly.
I think it's a shortcoming of warriors.
You know, people always
want to test the limit.
Whatever you're doing now will just be on steroids if you had money. If truly you wanted to go to brothels, there are brothels you can afford. I don't want that. You know, you have so yeah, you know.
Wouldn't you want to know what that's like?
Yeah, would you want to experience that craziness?
You know, to be
once?
Passed out under a pile of women and cocaine?
No.
I do.
You don't want to know?
A little bit.
Like, just once?
A little bit.
Just once? You
don't
want to do it.
I don't believe
a Lamborghini?
No.
In 10 Lamborghinis.
In a Bugatti.
It's not.
That's a car.
Just so you know, for the rest of your life, forever, every minute, that's available.
That's there.
You could do that. You know, it's not like you just turn it down once. You turn it down every minute, upon every hour, upon every day, for the rest of your life. That's fucking hard.
I get it.
Okay?
I get it.
Because one of those days, you're going to have a rough day. Yeah. You're going to be like,
you know what?
That
the
pile of women
and
thing?
The cocaine.
That sounds pretty good. Let's do that. That's the hard part.
I would at least once.
How the fuck?
Maybe when I was 18. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, you're wise and you're...
Stop being all smart and shit.
Yeah.
It's not even that. It's like when you've done...
Have you been in that yacht already?
In your life. You know, when you've lived, like, you know, like, you don't... You know, like, I'm not like, I gotta do all this, you know. But I guess if I'm not saying
you have to. It's just, like, knowing the option is there, would just be so hard.
But the option is, you can afford it right now.
Definitely not.
Nope.
Yes, you can.
Not the way I'd like to do it.
Yeah, no, we're thinking extravagant.
Not with the yacht and the private jets and the, you know.
Yeah, no.
You don't
need Dan Bazarian
money. You don't need a yacht and a private jet to have it.
Oh, definitely.
It's part of it.
Yeah. That's what, like, a big part of it.
It's probably the biggest part.
Yeah.
Okay. So when you're in a private jet with this pile
of women
and
cocaine,
handpicked,
what difference does it make that you're on ground?
What's the difference?
That you're on land.
It's just that I would feel important.
It's just a representation of power.
Just pure for Instagram.
For Instagram, really. And my penis.
for Instagram. You want to look good,
yeah,
under the pile of women that you're.
And you can't look good in a hotel.
Well, you just don't look as cool.
Not as cool.
Like you don't. You would look way.
No one's
cooler
gonna like that photo as much.
Jet. You're gonna get more likes. You get more likes for the one on the jet.
How will you take a picture in a jet with a pile of women?
Oh, one of the girls do it.
Yeah.
No. Uglier. Haven't they know that you are on a jet?
Selfie stick.
Yeah, bro. These are all fixable questions you're asking.
You put some thought into that.
Yeah. You don't think about this energy?
You don't? What's wrong? How, you've never thought about the cocaine jet pile of women?
Yeah, dude.
Sorry.
Oh, man.
It's been hours.
Oh, shit, it has been. All right,
well.
That's funny.
On that note.
Is that camera working?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been turning off here and there.
We'll fix
so,
it.
No worries.
I'm
but
here
we,
dropping
them
serious knowledge. And
this got you.
No, it didn't really miss much. It didn't really miss, but I think it's done.
Can we
trying to sound smart.
Can we plug Rocco before we go?
I'm going to turn this around just on Ingo.
There we go. We actually need it. That's perfect.
All right.
Just
Ingo.
In case
Ingo.
That one wasn't working.
Where can people find you?
Yeah, what's up?
People can find me everywhere. But more importantly, see this shirt? It says, I love... Oh, it's at the bottom. Out of it. It says, I love Rocca. This is a boxing class that I created. It's a really cool class. It's driven by African music. So it's not about, you know, like just... punching anyone, but it's like it's a fun class. It's driven by music. It's 45 minutes long, and you will burn a lot, like a ton of calories, sweat, and you won't even. It's like it's 12. It really is 12 rounds of work. So it's
12 three-minute rounds,
30-second breaks, and we're moving. We're doing different things.
And it's fucking hard.
At the end of the class, like people are sweating, but all of them have a smile on their face.
Yeah. All right.
Great. That's awesome. Class. Fuck. Check yeah. out www.rockafitness.com.
Dope.
Awesome.
Get this body if you
yeah.
do Rocca.
And you'll look like Ingo.
That's just fact.
If you work hard.
Literally.
You
Rocca does. So come check out the class. Hey, listen, the class is hard work.
Yeah, it's going to be hard. It's made by this guy.
Talking about rite of passage. That class is a rite of passage.
Send your adolescent males to become men.
Yeah. Yes.
Get those boat chewers over there.
Send your kids, your 18-year-olds, to take Rocca. That'll be a rite of passage. They'll become men when they come out of the 45 minutes.
Nice. All right.
They will come see me, goddammit.
Congratulations, Alec.
Yeah.
We did another episode.
It was fucking dope.
Number 20.
It was a good one. 2-0.
Yeah.
2 decades. 2-0.
2-0.
All right. That's a great number.
It's yeah, man. I feel good
number.
About it.
Yeah.
All right. Until next episode.
Bye.